first Rakes on the road. David, thank you coming along, volunteering.
Absolutely, sir. Pleasure.
I know you really well. Like, you don't know this. I've made it up on my own, and you haven't consented to it either. But I've always thought of you more as Chuckles Gandy.
Chuckles.
Chuckles Gandy. That's why.
Okay. Never
yeah.
mind that. I like to seem to.
Yeah.
And you're fairly.
I mean, there's other nicknames.
Easygoing, happy people, person. Yeah, I'm sure there's lots of nicknames that people have got for me. These are four letters, probably. which is actually the funny thing is that obviously people comment and stuff about, and they're like, why do you never smile in pictures? That's why my biggest comment, what do you smile more? I've got a nice smile. I'm generally, as you say, got quite a easygoing,
yes,
happy person, but I think people understand the way shooting fashion campaigns, I guess that there's not always this beaming, cheesy smile on your face that you wear, because I think it just look slightly strange.
There must be a time though. Or must have been a kind of tipping point where, as a model, you were an employee where you didn't necessarily have to think about those things.
Oh,
you
God,
were
no,
kind
no,
of
no,
the
no.
face.
Yeah, no,
but now your career has come to a point where you've sort of gone through the ranks and sort of you're able to kind of conceive of these things in your mind and make them manifest through yourself and your brand and your collaborations, etc.
Yeah,
so when was the kind of crossover, and was that always did you always have a sense that you wanted to have more of a kind of creative input?
Yes, I mean definitely I always wanted a bit of a creative input. Of course, when you first start in the business, you're there to learn, you're there to hopefully you absorb everything that working with the best creatives can kind of give you. I was there to be the face of whatever we were trying to shoot at the time, and they were casting you to play a role.
Yeah.
You know, whatever that creative was, that was your job. And of course that kind of changes, especially when you have your name on the brand or you're an ambassador, or and then the creative side can come out. But I remember suggesting something once to a very famous photographer. And he said, it was a few years into the modelling thing, I said, well, I don't think that's true. I think you should do it like this. And he said, David, don't jump before you can walk off. And it was a very polite shut the F up,
yeah,
basically.
Shut the fuck up.
And I was like, absolutely, sir, no worries about it.
Roger that. So, Dave, what are we in? Because I feel like I'm in something sort of dangerous but sexy. Do you know what I mean?
Oh God, I hope you never said that to the wife. We are in I feel like I'm in something dangerous but sexy. Get out, okay. Oh, it's alright. Please have that on your business card from now on. Tom Tamlin, dangerous but sexy. The Rake. Oh dear. We are in this.
You're a father, David.
I know.
Sorry.
Oh, dear.
Okay.
Put me in this car, and this is what you get. So this is a. This is from the Special Vehicles Operation of Jaguar. It's a, it's called the Project 8. They did the Project 6, the Project 7. It's their limited edition cars.
Yeah.
And this is one of 300,
yeah,
based on the very humble Jaguar XE saloon. As in, as you said, five seat saloon car. And I think they basically just let the engineers go to town and kind of said, What can you do with an XE? And it's one of 300 cars, 600 brake horsepower, and actually holds now the record for the quickest saloon car around the Nürburgring.
Okay.
So it held this record. The story kind of goes that manufacturers can try and break this record of the fastest saloon car, the fastest sports car, anything, and a certain amount of time of year. And on the last lap of the last kind of hour, Jaguar caught the record.
Yeah.
And a lot of people said, well, okay, but manufacturers, if they had more time, could probably beat it. So Jaguar went back the year later and broke their own record just to prove that it was the fastest
Excellent.
Goal. So that is this, and it is astonishing.
Shat my pants. I'd shat myself. How long have you been associated with Jaguar?
Since about 2008, 2009.
Right. So you've seen a fair revolution, I mean, because over that time
cars have changed.
Huge
evolution of cars, absolutely. Yeah, yeah. Not really just the brand, just, you know, in cars in general.
Yeah.
It's, you know, which makes it kind of like, I say the same thing about, you know, the fashion industry, about shooting, going from film to digital. So now even digital is now phones and 5K GoPros, and to see that, you know, sort of evolution of everything that's going through, and that's a bit like the motor car, you know, are we seeing really... because electric cars, I think, actually, manufacturers have done an incredible job at bringing that technology to the customer in mass so quickly. However, I'm seeing them more as a bit like Tesla's a tech company. It's a bit like driving a tech company. There is no engine. It's a bit like a computer.
Yeah.
But you know, we all probably have to say now that within 15 years, we are all probably going to be driving either a hybrid or electric car.
Yeah. There is a... I think to an extent, men have been given permission to do things that they hadn't had permission a generation before. What I mean by that is that grooming or styling themselves, there was... that wasn't considered kind of manly.
No.
And so we... So people having a sort of shaving routine or a grooming routine, what they do with their hair, the moisturisers they use, all these sorts of things, that just wasn't really allowed. And people sort of, especially in Britain, it was seen as sort of wet.
I love that, especially in Britain.
Yeah. You know, my father might as well have used sort of battery acid for sort of aftershave, like it was kind of like, ow, you know, the pain is the thing, this is what you need, it's good for you. And it was like, crap. But he's like very old, he was born during the war, so everything, you know, everything was sort of, in his life growing up, was sort of rationing, very minimalist. Like, you didn't have things. And now we're very fortunate where we can kind of express ourselves differently and do things that were considered emasculine prior to now.
Yeah.
And I think that is the positive thing towards sort of places like D.R. Harris, or Pankhurst, or a place like that. People will go and check out the different products they've got and get excited about finding something that works for them and they enjoy the smell of and they enjoy the feeling of using, and you know, they get frustrated when they run out of it. You know, those are sort of, these are aspects to men's, you know, preparation that weren't there 30 years ago.
And so
I think that there are, and I think it's sort of the same with styling. People are becoming braver with the choices that they're making because they feel like things work for them. There's a response from their friends, response from sort of dates or people out and about. So there's a sort of a tangible benefit from sort of styling for people these days. That I think is an exciting aspect of menswear, which is that men feel less inhibited to give it a go.
Yeah, or ask the question.
Yeah.
Wicked.
Okay, so David and I were talking earlier about how cars in the modern era are fantastic,
But they lack the kind of romance that I think the classic car has, and people like the fact that it may not necessarily be the most high tech, but there's something about the analog that people can't resist. And I think the same goes for this gun here. This is a hammer gun from Purdey. They only make two or three a year, but as you can see, it is, I mean, could anything be more old fashioned or antediluvian looking, but is anything more wonderful? And we're gonna have a go at shooting it.
Come in now.
Good question. When someone's coming, you know, going from the right, you have to more distance than the ones going to the left.
So right, so that's all to do. Think again. I'm going to go to tennis with this.
Yeah.
Okay. Think of it a forehand and backhand. Okay.
Right.
If we walked into, let's say, the middle of Trafalgar Square, this bucket full of tennis balls, and I said to you, David, select 100 people, okay, and just get them to hit me a tennis ball across the court. Everybody is their natural movement. If they're right-handed, they play a forehand shot because it's from movement from right to left. When you've got the gun on your right handed, you're always keeping that gun with your master eye the whole time. Anything going from the left to the right, look to go sort of two times further up for that lead. And it's all right to do with that movement away from the face.
Okay.
Okay? Try your best. Don't look at that gun for me.
Yeah.
Pull. Look at the clay. And that's the difference. Eyes on the prize. Perfect. There. Yep. Right. In they go. Okay,
closer.
Hammer, hammer, safety. I think you've got the hang of it now.
Yep.
Yep. Good. Right. Okay, Mike. Here we go. Ooh. And again. Same one. Yeah. Right. I'm going to see. Hammer, hammer. Out to your left.
Okay.
You ready? Lovely.
So even the ones coming here is
even the ones
in front
of
it.
Yeah, you've got to get out the front door of them.
Bloody hell. Okay.
Okay. So just like we did on all the others, see it, follow it, accelerate through where you feel roughly, you're roughly 6 feet. As I said, don't be exact about that measurement, just estimate it. Give it a squeeze and I'll let you know if we need to go a bit more or a bit less.
Got
okay,
you, yep.
That's
thank
all yours,
you.
Sir. Here we go. Right. Open.
Starting off in the same
roughly,
or
just bit, that's it, where you are there.
Okay.
Great. Okay. And ready. Good technique. Through. Lovely. Very tricky because you can't see with your eyes shut where you've got one with the clay. Ooh, you just overdid it. Well shot.
I thought that's right.
That really well. Thank you, Mike.
So that was fun.
So much fun. I mean, you're pretty good as I was highly impressed.
I don't know if that's entirely true. The great satisfaction of firing a gun like that, I think there's a great stress relief into it. And then seeing a clay sort of just disappear is always very, very nice.
Hitting one clean and saying it
it's
if you
great.
Nick one, it's quite not satisfactory.
It's glancing it to the side. But it's funny, that sort of thing, because, you know, the guns we were holding were genuine, I think, works of art. I mean, in the same way that a car is, or a suit, or a pair of bespoke shoes, or whatever, anything that's sort of handmade like that, you know, they do make them extremely beautifully. So I think Purdey did a lovely job.
No, I did love that you said you basically hit the hardest ones and missed the easiest ones.
Yeah, that's good, Dad.
Which I'm not quite sure what that says about me. You
need to make life difficult for yourself. So, what got you into looking after dogs and animals? Tell me about that side of your life.
So I always wanted to be a vet. If I could give up everything now and someone told me that I would suddenly become, you know, intelligent enough to get my exams through, I would do it still to this day and give up everything to go and do it. I love animals, always have. I worked at animal centres when I was 15. There was always side to me that I always thought if I got to a certain position in life, certain standing, that I would, charity is a, I would always want to give back. Mm-hmm. And the natural choice where it was kind of with animals first of all. Now we've got lots of animal, mental health charities, educational charities and stuff like that. But you know, Battersea was the one. It's all my charities as well. They're not particularly the biggest of charities. Battersea's, is relatively small to compare to, other things like UNICEF or Red Nose or anything of those. So I always try and support smaller charities where I think you can make a difference and see where the difference is going.
What's a kind of a hobby of yours outside of the work you do that people don't know about?
Keen cook, I suppose. I cook a lot.
What's your favourite dish?
Hobby. I will challenge anyone to a roast potato off.
Oh, really?
Yes.
That's interesting, because that's a bit it's a big deal, roast potatoes.
They are.
To anyone not watching from the UK who don't understand this, a roast potato is a very important thing. My wife, I think, makes the best roast potatoes. Let's put that on the record.
You'll keep that bit in there.
Yeah. Do you find that you're limited to keep your physique, etc.?
No, I eat everything pretty much.
Really?
I suppose I say that, don't I? I mean, do I eat everything? No, I don't eat fast food. I don't eat much processed food.
Right.
But when you talk about, you may not think I eat, people go, oh, carbs and butter and full fat milk and stuff like that. All organic.
Yeah.
You know, I'm particularly pedantic about things being organic. But that's not what you've got to worry about. Dieting is about processed foods and white foods and the madness. We got through an interesting one. I did this. There's a foundation with Jamie Oliver called Bite Back 2030. He's trying to break this reliance on processed and kind of fast foods, and try and get the obesity levels. We're the most obese nation in Europe, and especially in young people, huge problem, which leads to so many other problems with NHS and waiting lists and diabetes, and of course diabetes now is a big thing, and obese, and being obese with COVID, of course. And they did this incredible video where they took teenagers and they said, go to a restaurant, we'll give you the menu, there'll be an envelope in front of you, don't open the envelope, choose whatever you want, eat it, it's on us. And anyway, they went and then they said, right, now open the envelope. They opened the envelope and it had exactly what they had chosen on the menu.
Yeah.
And they said, how on earth did you know that? And they said, because we have been planting in your social media and places you've been, in advertising boards, in the back of taxis, near where the seat goes up, on the back of there, we got an influencer to talk about chicken. We planted it so you made sure you watch it. We put in a couple of adverts, and they did this with lots of things, and all they went in and they subliminally chose that bite.
Interesting.
So the Bite Back 2030 worked hard, and all the ambassadors, I'm ambassador for the charity, but all the spokesmen are children. So it's not coming from me, it's not coming from Jamie, it's not coming from, telling people, it's actually coming from, as I suppose, the horse's mouth saying, we want, a cut down in advertising of fast food, we want choices, we want healthy choices in our schools and on our high streets and everything. And we did a lot to, signed a petition to Boris Johnson about no fast food being advertised before 9 p.m. Like the watershed.
Oh yes.
And they proved
that's becoming a thing, isn't it?
Yes, actually. And lots of people said, oh, that won't make a difference, which I have to really disagree with, knowing what the videos we produced.
Yeah.
And also, if advertising doesn't work, what on earth are we all doing? Yeah. What's your room 101? Even things that just annoy you. Like, but you could just
really annoying because we had dinner the other night and
apart from the airspeed camera people going past, that I'm not sure I had that one. But one of them is dishwashers. Now, it's not the dishwasher, because that is a genius invention that saves us so much time. It's the arguments that come from the dishwasher.
What is it? Do you put the...
One about loading.
Facing up or down.
Well, yeah, that's true. Yeah. And it's where you have a sink by a dishwasher, and people finish it, or they think they're helping,
yes,
and they'll get dishes, and they'll put them in the sink. The dishwasher is next to the sink. It will take you 3 seconds to put it in the dishwasher.
Three seconds. At a dinner party, would it's say that out loud.
Absolutely, it drives me around the bend. And then, or they say, this is the clincher that absolutely does me. They go, yeah, the dishwasher was just washed and it's full. Empty it then. Empty the dishwasher and then put the plates in. Because at the moment, you put your plates in the sink. I have to now rinse that. I can't use the sink. That's useless. Just leave it on the side. If you're going to do it, leave it on the side. Or just leave it there.
People whose phone rings, that really irritates me.
Who actually makes calls now? I mean, who uses it as a phone now?
It's that, but everybody looks at their phones at all times, so let's just not make a noise out of it as well.
See, that's the new thing I started doing as well. Going back to calling people. Instead of this email chain of something that will go back to, you know, 5 hours of emailing,
yeah,
and I call people and I go, should we just sort out a finger in 3 minutes? Yeah. Okay, let's have a quick discussion. It's my new thing, it was something I thought about lockdown, I was like, I'm calling people.
I like a telegram.
I like a carrier pigeon.
Yeah, even better. Can't get a good carrier pigeon these days, though.
Otherwise, if someone said to me, what editor, what magazine has carrier pigeons to deliver, they said, I'd be like, Tom James.
Yeah, Tom James.
Yeah, loves a rule. Which from Tom? I'd love that. I'd love a pigeon.
Yeah.
Landing on anything and go, oh.
I mean, can you imagine?
It's from Tom.
Yeah, people also talk about how they get thank you letters, handwritten thank you letters, and they think it's just the nicest thing. Imagine if it was a pigeon. it's a big deal. Now, what, if you had one, would be one of the things you regret most in your career? And I will not allow something like, I'm just a bit too much of a perfectionist. Or I was too nice to everybody.
Something.
I could have made more money if I was more of a dick. I will not allow those answers.
Are these because these are things I told you before?
We've never spoken before.
Things I regret. Firstly, I've got to put it, I don't honestly really believe in regrets, to think there's no real point. I think if you learn from any mistakes, I think you learn from mistakes. I don't mind, you know, making mistakes. I think you learn so much from them. You know, the only other thing, you know, I've maybe tried the acting thing a little bit more seriously, because I was offered some things that were not necessarily my cup of tea. And I think that's why I said no to them.
Right.
And I always think, should I have done that? But then I don't think I would have had the love of it that other people have. I think I would have been maybe doing it for the wrong reason. It maybe just would have been nice to have tested myself, I think. I did a few little things. And I think I would have been more intrigued about the process. And it's actually what I would love to have with about that film is, you know how you have to learn to do so many things? Like if you're in an action film, you have to, you know, learn how to drive a car incredibly, or martial arts. I think that was the side I would have loved more than anything else. Or get really fat for a role.
That would be great. You heard Jared Leto was saying that when he had to get fat for a role, he basically just put like Ben and Jerry's tubs in the microwave and got soft and just drank them.
That
sounds to me like what I'm going to do tonight.